All right, guys, I'm Gabriel from Rio de Janeiro. Let's start this evening, this afternoon, lightning sessions with the third lecture from Philip Walters.
Thank you very much. After those holy words, it's very hard to keep up the level then now with the scientific lectures. Well, that's the last lecture today for you guys, and I'm still surprised how many days you managed to come here after those nice boat events and Caipirinha events and so on. As you can see from the title, today's focus is on quantum simulations. But before we jump in, a reminder was asked about literature also for the lectures that I gave 2 days ago. Basically, I think the easiest way to get access to those things I mentioned, like photonic measurement-based quantum computing, and blind quantum computing and verification, we're starting with the experimental papers, because what I learned from the past, that experimentalists try to make an experiment, the first have to digest the theory for something that's easy understandable. So I think very often it's nice to start there with the papers, and then of course you can take the real references from there where the original work was published. So all the slides, by the way, put just half an hour ago in a share file. So now, I don't know if Daniel is here, but please check if it worked properly, and then you should have something to read what's out there. As mentioned, simulation is today's topic. Today I would like to cover three, or depending on the time, four different subjects. The first is an analog simulation we've done a couple of years ago to get insights into frustrated spin systems by using photonics, which is somehow not that easy to understand from the first point of view, how photons can mimic spins. Then we built a digital quantum simulator, explain it later on what that is. I will also jump to Bose sampling, where already something was mentioned in a few lectures these days, sampling problem and so on, where photons are a very handy system to do experiments. And a couple of groups basically have done this back to back in papers. And then depending on the time, I would like to show that we simulate slash get insights also into other ways of processing data, or basically building simulators by hopefully showing how we can superimpose quantum gates, so even simulate or study other mathematical frameworks that would describe quantum mechanics, which is in the broadest sense somewhat related to that field, but anyways, it's nice to show experience can get insights there. Okay, I like this cartoon. It's I've stolen it and I've forgotten actually from where, because I use it so often. It could be Seth Lloyd or somebody else. That's my understanding of a simulator. Basically, you go to the laboratory, you have access to something which you like to work with, and you prepare an easy state. Easy in the sense it's easy to prepare for you in the laboratory, and you know that this state basically is the starting point of some other state that's much more complicated, very hard with many interactions, and you would like to learn something from the target state. And what you do is, you start with your easy state, you do something in the laboratory, you turn knobs as shown by those two people, you let interactions happen, and at the end you get your target state there, which is the interesting guy you would like to study. And then you can say, take a real look at what's happening there. So the idea actually really spins off in the first discussions about quantum computing by Richard Feynman and actually Benioff, who was slightly earlier than Feynman. Okay, there's not the, also 82, but I missed here, forgotten to put in the reference. Who just figured out that actually when you describe quantum mechanical systems, as you all learned with solid state courses and quantum chemistry, it's a pain because you have Hilbert space, it grows exponentially, you have many, many, many equations immediately when you start to blow up your system. And therefore, of course, it's very hard to get the eigenvalues, the eigenstates, and so on. The suggestion was, why don't we use quantum physics itself to study quantum physics, because it's you get rid of the classical descriptions that are needed for obtaining such kind of mathematics. And then it took quite some time, and from actually 14 years that before, at that time qubits came out, the first ideas about these algorithms showed up, and basically Seth Lloyd rephrased this idea of quantum simulation in terms of quantum gates, and it turned out the same as here. You do have an exponential, you have a speed up, an exponential speed up in terms of the number of gates that are required to simulate the target state, to reach the target state. And basically here what's shown is you have your initial state, you go to the target that you have in mind as close as possible. You know, also here realistic assumptions are needed. You don't really get by 100% normally what you're looking for. However, the number of qubits and the number of gate scales are polynomially instead of exponentially in a triad of classical resources. Okay, I guess you're all familiar with that, but that's the core idea of a quantum simulator. And you can find many ways to do it, but the two main avenues are basically by building a quantum computer using gates, as shown here. We've seen these pictures basically in every talk for this week. You can use single qubit gates, two qubit gates, and then you perform the simulation, which is actually a computation, to the target state. Or you basically use different ways, and one very promising way, because now you don't need to really perform this actual computation from the textbook, is to perform some kind of analog simulator or adiabatic simulator. But again, you have initial state, and then you slowly drive the system to the target state without jumping to some excited levels. Okay, therefore it's called adiabatic quantum computation or quantum simulation. The parameters you choose to reach there really depends on the system you have in mind or the thing you would like to study. And that's basically how people draw it normally to reach out there. You might have seen many simulators already before people have thought about simulation by manipulating atoms. So when you have an EEC or cold atom cloud, you put them in a lattice, as shown here, atoms here, and then you have this, put them in potentials, where you have these two or three dimensional lasers making real potentials. Then you can simulate different physical interactions, because if the potential is high, basically get a sit like this, localized isolator, Mott isolator. If you decrease the potential, then of course they can here make these superfluid structures. And these transitions here on an optical cold atom system or PEC is something which is basically a simulation of superconductors, so some kind of phenomenon where electrons are localized or they can move around. If you have something smaller in mind, not like thousand atoms, they would like to have single atom addressability. You can take ions, for example, apply some external field, and you see how they're split up in free spins up and superimposed to free spins down. It also gives you insights to magnetic behavior and so on. That's a slide just for thrown in as an advertisement. We nowadays basically all experimental groups show to funding agencies, because it's now basically a revival of doing experiments by having simulators in mind, because they're so feasible. So the key message is here that we would like to study other systems by having photons or ions and so on. I explained already this slide that we have basically quantum orreries, where we really mimic other small systems to get new insights and maybe new conceptual ideas. And the point that's really so nice about the complexity of quantum physical systems is that already the number of 40 spins typically is so hard to calculate for complex interactions that supercomputers wouldn't give you the result in reasonable time. Okay? However, if you have quantum control, here I mean you have really good gates and good addressability, you would basically perform 40 qubits at a complex machinery computations or simulations that cannot be done with a classical device. And photons, in that sense, have some nice advantages by being mobile. I'll show you later why this is a nice feature. And of course, you can address them nicely individually by having paths and fibers and wave plates that give you basically the hands on that. Okay, so the thing I would like to discuss a little bit more in detail is something that's more or less at my heart of a background. So I have to confess, I'm a chemist by education, so I like to think of chemical bonds and these kind of things. And something is very interesting there, where many physicists until these days have questions and like to discuss phenomena that are really at the heart of quantum physics. Okay, what's a chemical bond? So I guess you're all familiar, if you have two hydrogen atoms and they put them close together, then they have this kind of bonding situation, a single bond, which means according to the Pauli principle, you get here a lower energy state where one electron from one hydrogen, or two hydrogens are here, they make this bond together, and you see what you get. Is basically a singlet state according to Pauli's exclusive principle. There must be different spin states. Since they're fermions, you get a minus sign. Please remember that when you do calculations with solid state physics or chemistry, then the hardest thing, remember, there's this Hamiltonian, HpI, no? And then the Hamiltonian is kinetic energy, easy to calculate, and potential energy. And here's like three contributions: Coulomb, exchange, and the correlation. The last one, the correlation, is the pain that kills you, that takes so much effort to get basically predictions there. And the point is the quantum correlation we have for free. Okay, so the language that we use here is this kind of entanglement, which is nice because you have access to that in the laboratory. I'm not saying you can do anything with that, all the features, but everything. But Some features like these correlations we get easily in laboratories, so that was our the idea we had in mind, let's take photons where we can play with the entanglement business. So my words and pictures, so such a system of electrons having a bonding situation, you can mimic the photons as well. If you take down conversion, you get an entangled state, but it can be created a singlet state, which again, even though it's bosons, it has many features which are similar to fermions, because you have this singlet state feature from minus sign here. So if you replace HV, you get a minus sign, which in many senses is a good approximation to fermionic systems. It's not the same, of course, but very often it's feasible to use those states. Okay, what's the challenge? So when I talk to solid state dyes, one of the biggest, well, very big interesting things is when you have Heisenberg interactions that allow you to have big systems, and there's basically two interesting situations. One is you always consider the highest level of occupied electrons. You don't have solid state systems, you have many shells, you don't care about the lower shells, you only concern about the highest bonding shells, because here the interesting physics takes place. And here solid state physics people, there's two scenarios, for example. As you remember, electrons want to make a bond, okay? So the simple cases, each neighbor makes a singlet state configuration as shown here. And when they're localized, they don't hop around, you can talk about a valence bond. Valence bond is the highest level. Valence bond solid, because the bonds do not hop around. However, there are cases where they become delocalized and you suddenly get long range, or like basically hopping configurations. You see, it's not only nearest neighbor, but sometimes it could be even longer, it's not shown here, but go to 3-4 lattice sites further away, becomes like not well basically established in terms of localization, and therefore it's called valence bond liquid states, like a liquid. It's also like something which is always shaking around. The interesting stuff is going from here to there is something happens in nature when you cool down superconductors. Here, isolator, you go below the critical temperature of high TCs, for example, some things become superconducting, which is still, as you know, an open challenge to understand entirely how those things work. Okay? Chemists start smiling about it. They say, well, we know this for many years longer than physicists, and we have this kind of aromatic system in mind, which is like, for example, you take carbons, you put six together to make this ring. Now, each carbon has four neighbors, so carbon has 1, 2, 3 neighbors, but there's one electron lonely, there's the partner missing. So what happens? It makes an extra bond, a pi bond, to this neighbor. And since it can choose to go left or right, it's all superposition of having three bonds hopping around. It's called aromaticity, which you might have learned in high school even. However, the situation is totally different to high TCs because it's the opposite. If it's hot, okay, then they're hopping around, and if it's cold, they freeze. Other way around. Here, if it's hot, then basically they freeze. If it's cold, they hop around. So it's different mechanisms, but somehow similar concepts of this delocalization of bonds. And bear in mind, we simulate such features with the photonic quantum simulator. So when you start a simulation, you have to have a roadmap in hand, in your head, how to do it, okay? What you do, you model something. So what's the easiest model? Take four spins, because it's two bonds, and that's the minimum thing you need. One bond, you're boring, nothing happens. There are two bonds, you can at least see something. So what you do is you take four spins, spin one half, easy situation. Actually, there's tons of literature, even from well-known guys, okay, studying this kind of stuff, where you take a spin tetramer or spin plaquette, and then you just spin 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you see what's going to happen there. So with that, you can actually simulate spin-frustrated systems by saying, well, no, if they are long, short range, just here and there localized, it would be like a solid state. And if they basically start to be less delocalized and really have a transition from mod isolator to something that's more interesting, like it happens really in the superconductors, as for example Anderson, famous guy in this business, conjectured with such situations. What you find in literature is like drawings like that. In the smallest case, to study this kind of high TC features, would be your superpositions of bonds two like this or two like that with a plus sign. It's called this S-wave pairing, and the thing you might have known from higher solid state physics courses is the D-wave pairing, which is basically the same situation, but not just with a minus sign in here. And you can also basically draw it as cartoons where you have this configuration or that configuration. And that's something we had in mind to study. So what you do is you study the spin tetramer, and you say, okay, what's interesting? The ground state. Always the ground state is the thing you would like to take care of. When you do literature research, you realize the ground states of such systems must be always spin zero state. There's even a theorem from Marshall who says No matter what, if you have high spring interactions, which mean X, Y, Z couplings, they always will spin zero ground state. There's something where, which can be helpful, basically when you basically perform interesting simulations to get insights there. So when you keep that in mind, it must be always spin zero. In other words, you always have to have two pairs because they sum up to zero. And they can have three configurations: this, that, or the X. Okay. Being a smart physicist, you realize, well, they're not all independent. No, only two of them, because it's obviously two-dimensional. Only two of them are independent. So it turns out that two of them span the entire space. In other words, these are the valence bond solids by definition. And if you basically now superimpose them, then you really get, for example, the minus sign, this X configuration, and so on. You can basically superimpose whatever you like, even weird ones like that. Okay? So if that means we understand what's happening there, we'd like to study the features. So what you need now is basically just, as shown here, the capability to have addressability, because what you do is you would like to turn interactions, high-spring interactions, to allow to change a configuration. And the nice thing is, as I just mentioned, the fact that you stay always in this spin zero ground state is something which photons are good for, because here you can force the simulator to stay always in the singlet subspace, and I'll show in a second how it goes. And that's the message here. When we realized together with other people that this can be done, we've seen these photons are really nice systems to choose to perform this kind of simulation. It was done actually as an analog simulation, because what you do is you rewrite your Hamiltonian in terms of two parameters. Okay, one configuration, S1 is 3 and S2 is 4, basically is this line and that line. This is the first dimers, and the other one is the horizontal ones. We see the coupling for one group, these guys, another coupling for that guys. This can be written as such a Hamiltonian. So what you do is now you start with an initial state, then you apply the knobs to basically effectively turn on the interactions, and you drive your system to something you'd like to study, some kind of configuration you have in mind. And what you do is you get some kind of perturbation. You have the Hamiltonian plus an extra term which comes from this kind of interaction. What you effectively do is you change the ratio of this coupling to that coupling. Only this is existing, the horizontal lines, on that existing, the vertical lines, so you have ratios of that, then you get different configurations as you would like to study. And by that you have a knob, you can really switch as you wish, from this to that configuration and so on, which really allows you to study somehow questions, open understandings of the superconductors or aromaticity by having something in the laboratory to look how the photons behave when you apply those things. Okay. So how to do that? Actually what you need photons, so of course you have two pairs, so you need two photon pairs as well. So as shown in the last 3 days, you take one down conversion first, another down conversion. We align to be basically singlet states coming out here. There's one singlet state, another singlet state. Now comes the interesting part, it's this element here, that we effectively introduce the Heisenberg interaction. Okay? So what does it mean, Heisenberg interaction? As I said before, we want to basically force ourselves to stay always in spin zero state. So what it means, you project here also singlet states. Okay? So how can this done with such a device? So here's the parameters, it was a parse tracer source, these are details. But the magic thing was this tunable beam splitter that allowed to really basically go to any target state we had in mind. So the thing that, and that comes to question, guys, if you understood something, but I can remember something I said last time about photons and beam splitters. You see, photon guys are very simple. We always like beam splitters. They basically covers 90% of our knowledge. But and then sometimes it's aware of it's enough. So as you remember, we talked about gates and basically photons are bosons, they like to bunch and so on. Okay? So normally when they come to beam splitter, they like to bunch, which is the core of the boson sampling and beams and so on. But here we'd like to have a different feature, which is also something remarkably photon. So when I have this kind of state, the singlet state. Okay.
Should I call?
You want the black color?
Yeah.
Now this is like magic ink, huh? Nobody sees. Two days. So we study basically this kind of Heisenberg interactions which lead to singlet states, you know, singlet state is special guy on its own. So what we have is HA, BB, and the opposite, VA, HB. Okay. So something interesting happens now when we have a beam splitter. Okay? We send one photon from this side, another photon from that side. And then again, two modes coming out. Let's call this here C. Let's call this one D. So what you get basically is, that was a little math, it's not that hard. So now basically we send one photon from here, and that's the partner, other photon in, okay? Yeah. Tangled, they have to come together. See? So what happens basically now is this guy gets superimposed going this path or that path with the eye reflection. Remember that from the last courses. So we get basically is, so H goes to D plus reflection D. So it's right, let's use the operator language, which is easier to understand, easier for the amplitudes. So we get here D H reflection plus I, that's C, H, dagger, and the other one here. So I forget, one square or two just put out, do it later then. The V guy comes from here, so it goes basically this way, so it becomes C, V dagger, and reflection here is plus I, D, V dagger, sorry. Just one term, minus, the other term, which goes like boom, boom. So B comes from A, because now here it's got D, V plus I, C, V dagger plus. H comes from B, so it goes straight, so it comes C, H dagger was reflected plus I, D, H. Okay. So what do we get? Basically it's pretty simple, so on 1 is 22, and then put here this basically is 1/2, now put it in. In the first term, it's like D dagger H plus this guy, C dagger V H. Now the last one plus I D, now with the other one, D H D V dagger plus. You see my level of mathematics I can handle basically. My, so that one C H dagger D V dagger. Zack. Minus 1/2 on the other side. D, V, C, H, that's easy, D, V, D, H, dagger, but this to this, plus I, V, V, dagger, D, H, dagger, plus I, C, V, dagger, C, H, dagger, minus, this minus, minus C, dagger, V, D, dagger. Okay, so why the heck do we care? So as we see, we lose many terms. So let's see who's similar. That D, H, D, C, to this guy.
D. First term in the last line. D, C.
First term, last line. Ding. D, V, C, H. Here. Yeah. Thank you. Wow. Impressed. Okay. Okay, guys, you see that there's a plus, there's a minus sign, okay? So basically, you have to keep in mind this minus cancelling out. So DH, so each term to be loose, we have DHDV here, we have DHDV here, so this term, because here's a minus, goes out, bam, bam. CHCV, okay, that means H and B in the same mode, H in the same mode, minus term here is also gone. So it survives basically is two times H and B in different modes, okay? And you see here, E, H, and V, V,
the other mode. So what you get at the end is a single state out, which is basically using this language, and I get a factor of 2, so we're fine, we lose this one half. So what you basically get here is h c v d minus v c h.
Can somebody explain why we suddenly see that we have the opposite effect, that all the photons that we send in now do not bunch? Why is this the case? Yes? What does it mean? The photons, they like to... So, give us the right answer, but it means photons are still bosons, but now you split polarization and spatial modes to give you freedom, okay? So basically, if you force photons with different polarization to the same mode, in other words, you force the single state to go in there, it would really violate the bosonic nature, because then they would share the same spatial mode, and they cannot basically be anti-symmetric if that sense. So the only way that nature has is to say, okay guys, you are singlet, you have fermionic configuration, you must go the other direction, okay? That's nice. So you see, in most of the cases, we really have bunching when we have indistinguishable photons, but not for the case, that's the only case, we have a singlet state, because then it's happening what's shown here, with everything going in particular to the opposite directions, which allows also to have a single state projection, okay? This is used for, back in the days, teleportation, other protocols, where if you force yourself to get a coincidence, when photons overlap coherently, then you know they must have been projected on a singlet state. And that's basically shown in a drawing. So the single state here only clicks as coincidence with the spoost now, you remember? On the Mandelbrot was the opposite, they would disappear if they're bosons, but now in this configuration as a single state, they basically are, there's anti-bunching, which is the name the photonic guys use. Okay. Good. So now you understand what's happening here, why it's so nice to stay in the ground state, because by projecting on a singlet state, no matter what you do, you always basically be in the spin zero subspace. So what's happening, you have this tunable beam splitter, which is a device where the strong here is nicely explained by arms. The photons come in fibers here and there. You take a fiber that has basically is naked. Okay, basically you remove the outer shell, so that the light field can slightly come out. I've shown this goose hanging effect. The light at the surface always has this evanescent field coming out. So if the modes, which spare fibers, okay, if you put them closed, there's a chance that the light in one arm can couple to the other one. So by the distance that you choose, you can really say they never see each other. Or make a total swap, that one guy jumps to the other mode with 100% efficiency, or if you choose the right distance, like a 50-50 beam splitter. So that's what's shown here. Light here, distance there, couples to the other side. Of course, it must be done in a proper way. You have a liquid in between to be smooth, just the right reflective index and so on. But by choosing this distance far away, light stays in, half the way, 50-50, and total on top of each other, you convert one mode into the other mode with 100% efficiency. And by that, but the distance that you have in your hand, you have the knob to control the spin state that comes at 1, 2, 3, 4 photons to be here, there, or any superposition. And it was done with this simulation a couple of years ago. So what you do is you take data from each configuration, you turn the knob as you wish, and what you get is many coincidences, you expect what you like to do, you get for configurations like this, you can make reconstruct the density matrix if you would like to study the correlations in there. You see correlations here look different than there, and so on. And you also can basically, it's not my Skype, you can also basically refer energies to different configuration by mapping them the total energy of the systems, and you see how the points nicely basically fit on that curve with the reasonable error bars. So now you can ask, why the heck do you care? Why do you do this kind of experiment? Okay, it's just like 4 photons, small system. Because I think that's one of the nicest features in our business. We learn to talk or to argue with different wording and arguments than other communities. So we can use quantum information concepts to understand why solid state physics work this way. Okay? Of course, solid state physics know precisely what's happening there. They give you better, much better answers than this simulation can do. However, you can explain from different reasons why we see those effects. So what do I mean? I mean that we basically studied the situation for each configuration. We've seen that no matter how we align our tunable beam splitter, we always basically are restricted to 2 singlet states. So as shown here, no matter what kind of parameter, that's the beam splitter ratio, what you choose, the total amount of entanglement in the system stays the same. these quantum guys would say, obviously, there can be only one partner for maximum entanglement. You cannot have bell pairs to more than two partners. So it means no matter what, you stay always with the total amount of energy or entanglement in there. But what nature does, it says, okay, the way to rescue the situation is to delocalize the bonds. There's still only two in there, but you're allowed to hop around. And that's what's shown here. So when you study such a configuration, two bonds here, now we look basically at the singlet state between one neighbor, which is the same as the energy, how much energy you get from such a bond. So now we see basically at this point, we look at the energy of this cross. Okay, one bond. We change the interaction, what you see is the energy goes down, which is another word for the bonding gets weaker, okay? But at the same time, you see a new bonding starts, the red one, which is the bond to this neighbor here. You see, it's like this atom, you lose the bond to your lower guy on the right side, but you build up a new bond to this one. Of course, the point here in the middle is the degenerated case, you have both superpositions, both configurations superimposed to each other. Now you see, if one goes down, the other one comes up until you reach that point, and you go further down, you see this one disappears, zoop, but you see a new bond comes up, which is dead, and you have these two cases of degenerate superpositions. If you ask why is this lower, because there was a pure quantum effect in the setup, and due to these realistic conditions, it's not that here is having the starting points. So the answer is, you understand, and there was a nice phrase also for the press, that monogamy, okay, is a bad thing in that sense, because it leads to frustration, to spin frustration. You can imagine that in the news when they say, scientists prove monogamy leads to frustration, it's like a big hype. But in principle, what you see is that what quantum monogamy says, yes, no matter how you tune turn on the Heisenberg interactions, you are limited to two bonds, and the way to get out of that is basically that you hop around, which is the frustrated spin system. So in other words, simple quantum physics gives you an intuition, quantum ordering, okay? Why you observe those things without those complicated framework of a much deeper theory, of course, which is richer in some senses, but sometimes you miss the point there. In principle, we can blow it up to bigger systems, and it was shown that just by adding also configurations along these lines, plus having one pair extra, like six pins, we have already the smallest unit for cases that are related to the big case. In big cases, the thermodynamic limit is basically a big system that can really study more important phase transitions. And you have in mind to do such experiment with probably three down conversions to study something that's more related to real scenarios out there with material you have really in your hands at the end of the day. Good. The other thing, I would like to show us you can also build something which is slightly different. So what I've shown you is an analog simulator because you really drive the system by turning the knob from one state to the target state. But you can also build, as shown before, a simulator out of gates. You know, you can really say, okay, I'm a computer guy, I like to work with C nodes and so on, and that's okay, also fair enough. You know, we've done something like that in an experiment. So it turned out there are a few Hamiltonians that are nice to solve because they're integratable, so there are solutions in one dimension. One of them is this XY interacting spin systems. So solvable means you find ways where you can rephrase the coupling into gates. And if you have access to that, it's nice to perform the simulation. So what we had in mind is to study two spins, so we move from four to two, okay? But now two spins in a so-called XY coupling. You see coupling in X, coupling Y. And then, of course, to have more fun, we need some parameter that's interesting that kicks in to change the system. So an external magnetic field here acting on one and the other spin is shown as this term here. So what you do is now you have to map your interacting spin to something that's not interacting, basically to solve the situation. What you do is basically perform this kind of unitary maps, interaction and non-interactions. What you see is some kind of match gate, as was shown there. You know, an Esther mentioned this to me that this is a match gate, and photons are very nice to implement such things. Match gate because it's symmetric. You see outside this kind of structure, inside this core structure. Or like a Jordan-Wiegner transformation, if you want, this kind of case. So what you get then at the end is you have this free particle Hamiltonians, which means you can diagonalize, and then you get, of course, the energies easily from those spin states, which allows me to extract all the information you'd like to do. So in other words, what do you mean by mapping from interacting to non-interacting spins? For me, it's easy to understand the other way. So what you do in the laboratory, you study a few product states of two spins, so 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. And then you do something to reach the target state where the actions of the XY motor, for example, show up. So what you do is, you have this kind of starting point, you figure out how to implement the unitary, by using gates, for example, and then you look at the target state. For this simple case, of course, you can do the math. So what turns out is you get this kind of entangled state. You see, first state is kind of phi plus state, the second one is a psi minus, this was psi plus, and here's a phi, should be phi minus state, something like that. The interesting thing is, you see that is this term x. And x basically covers the interaction strength from outside, from the magnetic field. So we see that this guy and that kind of state, ground state and highest excited states, they get affected by the magnetic field. And this you can simulate. So in other words, while these guys will never be bothered by some magnetic field from the outside, these effectively do. And of course the energy is also affected by it. You see that he kicks B in, here's B, and here there's no B at all. So what you do is now, okay, so let's build the machine, let's see if this is happening. So what you realize then is you can implement such a unitary by, you don't have to go through the details here, but basically by using two C-nodes, one C-node here, another C-node there, and then you have local operations here. That's the nice thing of photons. Local knobs, polarizers and so on, it can basically change the mimic magnetic fields, okay, in a computer. Oopsie. And that was done. So, being a lazy physicist, you say, well, sometimes you don't need to build full C-knots, okay? As I've shown before, this kind of BBO crystals give you entanglement for free, so why don't we say the first crystal is effectively a C-knot? The C-knot should give you entanglement. So this was done. So instead of having two full C-knots, the first C-knot was put into the state generation from the down conversion crystal, so you were just ending one C-knot at the end, this kind of local operations. So how does that look like? Now it's pretty straightforward, down conversion crystal for the entanglement source, and then as we've talked the last times, this kind of partially polarizing beam splitter to make an effective C-knot, and then by the measurements at the end. And here these important knobs are this black box and that black box, they can really turn parameters to simulate different magnetic fields. And then you look, hey guys, is the state changing as the theory predicts according to this situation? And this is basically what's happening. So now you get the results, and you can really, again, look at the correlations of the photons by looking how the polarization looks like to each other. And what you see is for the four states, that here look at, for example, XX, it's 45 degree basis correlations. You see one guy never changes its correlation, here the blue and the red one, no matter how you turn the knobs, whereas the other guys nicely follow some kind of behavior of changing. And you see this changes also the correlation strength or the energy, if you want, in some respect. Same is true for this YY correlation, or ZZ correlation, or Z correlation. So you really get this correlation map, the source set theory, the guys normally study things. And the fidelity stays the same, it means you don't change the quality of your apparatus well and turning knobs in there. Good, that was the end. So it was basically interesting to study and said, yes, in principle we can also build something out of gates. But photons have some features which are nice to use for other things. And the other things, which is at the interface of computing or simulating. For me, simulation means it's not a full computation. Basically, you look at something that's just interesting for you. It's like a shortcut. For me, computation means you can do whatever you like. But a simulator is like a special purpose device just to look for some particular question. And there's another name, which like intermediate quantum computing, is also says you build a special purpose quantum computer for just asking one particular question. Couldn't be the most interesting one, but still, it sometimes makes you happy to ask for one particular thing. So Bose assembling was mentioned already a few times here, so we'll rather keep it short, but you hopefully can see again the photons are nicely suitable for such a thing. So first, the plus, okay? Something that works very nice for photons is where you don't need measurements, where you don't need gates, okay? And one thing where you don't need gates, you still can do something interesting, is to make a unitary transformation. So what you'll show is, if you have basically one photon which can come from this mode, or this mode, or that mode, like a big vector, okay, which just probabilities are where this photon can be found, then you can easily map this input state to this output state there, okay? So it was shown that a mapping is called unitary transformation of arbitrary size n can be basically broken into smaller pieces of just, you see, this element, which is nothing else than the Mach 10 that I've shown you before. Remember, two beam splitters, one phase allows you to basically give control of one qubit, basically an SU2 operation. It was shown, actually a big thing can also be broken down into smaller Mach-Zehners. You can see many of those elements here, basically put together this big, big machinery. And the nice thing is, it really scales in a nice way. So it's an efficient process to build such a unitary transformator. And it turns out the number of beam splitters is n, n is the number of modes, okay, that you have here. Just n times n minus 1 half. So in the simplest case, here's my pen, sure. No, you don't need light, it's just very short. But it's in the simplest case of three modes, one mode, second mode, third mode. So we need some kind of arrangement of beam splitters to address these two guys. That's the first x. Then of course these two guys, this x, and then the last one. Okay? So basically need these kind of three boxes that allow to interact all of the modes. So according to the rules, this dot d is equal to 3. So what we get is 3 times 2 half equals 3. Okay? So now I might say, factually, you say beam splitters, okay? Three beam splitters. But these boxes, when we talked about Mach-Zehners, these kind of constructions that you told us last time, is two beam splitters, no? So this would be 2, 4, 6, and here dimension only 3. Actually, it doesn't matter the difference, because in theory, you can also put such a device, okay, by one beam splitter, they can basically change delta T to delta R, they can change the reflectivity. You can get the same device, the same properties, if you're willing to have one tunable beam splitter. But often it's very simple to build such a device, it's just a factor of 2. But in principle, the construction of such a device scales very nicely. It was shown already 20 years ago that this can be done. However, it turned again 20 years to realize, well, there are interesting questions out there where we use this kind of feature to build something without big effort, any big effort. Okay. And of course, that's also one of the interesting developments in, from the technology side, that such a beast, you know, can imagine beam splitters and mirrors, can basically shrink to something which is like a fingernail size by using integrated optics. Integrated optics is what you see here in a picture, different modes, you guide them together and you can have beam splitters with a couple. So this I actually would like to show you in more detail. So I go to this point again, sorry. So what's nice about integrated optics, you basically have a solid state fiber, okay? You know, photons fly normally in free space from mirror to mirror. But if you'd like to have something handy to guide, then you have something like fibers, which you know from classic communication. Fibers is a principal device where you have something like this. As all of you hopefully cut a fiber in your life to see how it looks like. Okay. So you couple in light at some particular angle, and then you have this kind of total reflection, okay, of light. This is only happening because you have materials with one reflective index here, another reflective index outside. You know, prism, you need different reflective indices. Question, where's high reflective index? Here, inside or outside? Wrong, inside. Total reflection, okay? 50-50 was wrong, but good try. Okay? So n pi must be bigger than 1. Make the drawings of a prism, okay? There's the air, there's the prism glass, you remember high school, it must be thicker. So how can you build such a fiber in solid state? You can, well, there's two approaches. One is the old approach done by Bristol, does it all the time. Bristol. And most of them, and also the people in UQ. So what you do is you do etching. What you do is you take glass, and then you etch modes like this, like a cube where the light basically propagates even such a mode. Plus, okay? Low loss, you can do it of high quality. You can imagine, you must have a smooth surface in there that the light doesn't really scatter wrong in the wrong direction. So you can have very nice properties. Basically what you have in bark, the spark and the light travels, that's my light, okay? Travels in here, in this kind of square. You can really build very nice cubes. The problem is, you cannot handle polarization, because the polarization propagation depends on the shape. A square, you can imagine, if the light goes like this, is different than coming at the edge zone. So if you don't care about polarization, you just want to act in a special mode, as I've shown before, totally fine. If you would like to handle polarization, increase your freedom, you look typically for something that looks like round, okay? So one way to do it, so let's call it, this way is called chemical etching, etching techniques. The thing others are doing, and including us, is to use basically laser written circuits, which means you just take a piece of glass, okay, and take a laser, a strong one, it makes a shot here, like poof. A pulsed laser, and it makes shot by shot, but then you really make a guide. You can really guide the light as you wish, or another guide like that, okay? So, I'll show you a picture later on if you can't see my drawing here. So the thing that happens here is extremely nice, so nobody knows precisely, but the qualitative answer is, glasses, as you know, when you look at the old church glasses that run down, you see there's this belly, the old church glasses down there. However, when the laser comes, it locally melts the glass. Okay? And the glass gets immediately rigid again. But it changes configuration. It turns from a loose configuration, so silicon oxide basically, it turns from a loose configuration like that, makes this kind of weird, to after the laser, the melting, becomes thicker, like smaller spacings. Okay? So what you do is by heating up and cooling down, you effectively make a high refractive index there. It's not much, but sufficient to guide the light. And if the laser is smooth, and this technology people have to learn over the years, if you do it properly, you really make smooth surfaces that allow you to propagate polarization states. So an H photon is treated the same way as a B photon and so on, which is done here. But still, that's ongoing research where the trade-off here is it has higher losses, because as you can imagine, it's harder to write if the laser shot for shot a smoother surface, which means we have basically 20 to 50% losses still in the channel, okay? But we work on that. Okay, so my drawing here a little nicer. So for the laser writing, which we do in our case with people from Germany, the laser comes, you move the glass, but you really etch your path, so you see that's basically the shot where you melt the glass, you really make here the travel path for the photons as they would. And the beam splitters are done by guiding modes together with some different spacing, and if you know basically how far they are apart, then you really can decide a 50-50 beam split, or 90-10, whatever you have in mind. And having access to polarization degrees of freedom, you can really put such a CNOT gate we talked in the first lecture on a glass chip of that size, which is much smaller than the video I've shown to you where you have this 1 meter times 1 meter optics table. So that's basically what we have in mind to do. Okay, the thing that helps a little bit to the situation that those guys have some losses, higher losses than in free space, is, as I mentioned, new detectors, because I have seen there are some questions about how those work, so there's one or two slides about the technology side. The interesting business is to have to choose the wavelength, where fibers, and this kind of piece of glass, which basically is a fiber, has the lowest loss. And it turned out at 50 nanometers, that's basically out of this visible light, is the lowest loss for these photons. The problem is lower energy, means higher nanometers, has basically no efficiency detectors if the band is weaker from the photons. You want, because we want X-rays, you see every photon, okay? But X-ray doesn't work in the laboratories, so you find visible light regimes, green better than red and so on. But if you go to 50-50, with the lowest loss, you had until recently only bad detectors. They were totally blind. But with new technology, we could basically, people could improve the situation. You see, the wavelength you want is this one. You had in old days 10%, but now with the new superconductor circuits, and I'll show you in a second how they go, you can really go to the high 90s, which means you reach finally the regime. You can have interesting technology boosting our experiments to higher qualities and interesting results. And you see it goes in exponentially, the efficiency of the basic efficiency of the detector times the number of photons you have in mind, and really see how the count rates boost up with that. As I said, factor of 2 or 3 is nowadays possible, which already boosts 6 photon count rates by a factor of 100. Superconductors, just a little hint what I mean by that. So not the simulation as mentioned before, not really technology. It's a very nice new development over the last 15 years where you get something that's superconducting, like nanowires or some small elements, small to cool down rapidly again. What happens now, you have basically like this superconducting feature, and if you heat up by one photon, then basically you change the situation from being not superconducting anymore, but having a hot spot. Of course, then the resistivity, which is zero superconductors, is not zero anymore because it doesn't, it's not superconducting anymore. So you see a jump in your current, and therefore you can say, yes, there was a photon arriving. So superconductor, photon comes, superconductivity breaks down. It's like here, so the hot spot makes a breakdown. Then you can read out the change of current, and then again you cool down to be ready again. That's the idea. So you basically build nano wires like that, that's the micron scaling. You put them in a cryostat, as shown here. Here you see a fiber going to some small nanodetector, signal comes out. What's nice over these days, so now more and more companies build that, so that at the end of the day, it's really a question of money only to buy such things, not anymore hardcore development, which allows quantum opticians as us to focus again on the experiments. So it means cryostat are needed because it must be like an order of 1 Kelvin. You put nanowires in and then you can improve the efficiency of nanowires by putting a little cavity around to collect even more light. But these are just details for the devices. Good, going back to what photons are nice for, this kind of unitary one is a photon in, photon out goes very nicely. You can see why we like to show those circuits because it can be really done on a very small scale. The situation gets interesting when you talk about more than one photon. Okay, so people have not more than one photon in mind. Just a reminder, such a situation does not allow universal quantum computing. Even though you can implement unitaries efficiently, it's not sufficient for entire quantum computing or universal quantum computing. You can imagine you cannot make entanglement out of that and so on. So you will need additional resources like a swap gate or CNOT gate to make a full package. But for many stuff, many applications, that's sufficient to have just such a unitary in your hands. Okay, boson sampling in one line, so I hope that's, that's something you can handle after all those lectures. If you have the simplest case one beam splitter, as shown here, then we've talked about that, if two photons come, they bunch, which means if you look at the coincidences, the terms of both being transmitted and both being reflected vanish. If you look at the beam splitter matrix, which is this one I1, I always write down, then you see what you do is for look, when you look at the coincidences here and there, you add this term and that term. So you see AD plus BC, which at the end is similar to calculating the determinant. You know, when you have this mathematics, you get this plus minus signs there. If only plus a sign exists, then it's not a determinant but a permanent, which is shown here. Effectively, you get the permanent squared because of, you know, quantum mechanics, one rule, and so on. And as people talk all the time, and I just mentioned here, it's very interesting because problems related to such permanence are extremely hard. The class of sharp P, which is like harder than a salesman problem. It's as hard as asking how many best solutions even exist for something like a salesman problem, okay? So it's really extremely hard. And the nice feature is that even stuff that's related to such things, like saying like just telling photons shot by shot, and you see, okay, how it's sampled randomly, how they come out, even those things are very hard, which makes boson sampling, which is the terminology for sending many photons in, you just want to see how they come out, you don't care actually what's happening. This is very hard to do in a classical device. So hard that under ideal conditions, which we do not have, okay, but on the paper at least, 20 photons here, and you have basically 400 modes, okay, you would basically reach a regime where no classical device currently can predict or sample what's coming out. That's great, no? 20 photons is not crazy. 400 modes is meant for free. It means no gates, no measurements, no signals, just like this integrated stuff, for example. And if it works everything perfectly, no losses, and you're really totally happy, that's it, okay? And that's amazing. So what we have done is the first step towards 20 is not 2, but 3. 2 was done many years ago. Other groups had the same idea. 3 is already the first non-trivial case. So you basically take such a device, you have 5 modes, you send in 3 photons, and then you sample and you see basically the likelihood of photons come out here is green is the prediction, and red is the green is the result, and red is the theoretical prediction that we had on those. Here's a real picture, that's a real image of our chip. If you send strong light, then you see still scattering, and here you see the fluorescence happening in there, which nicely shows our unitary. I did not mention, because it was mentioned before that, yes?
And what's the source of these 3 photons?
A down conversion, the one crystal.
So,
that's the source. So down conversion gives you one pair. But if you have two crystals, you can have sometimes two pairs, okay? But it's as likely that one crystal gives you also two pairs at the same time. So what we do is we pump very hard that sometimes even two pairs at the same time are generated. That's happening here. So two pairs come out for photons. If you're not in polarization state, you can split them that one guy is a trigger, and the second, the third, and the fourth photon go in here. So three photons go in there, and one photon is the trigger. If you pump even harder and you wait even longer, then sometimes you have three pairs coming out, even four pairs coming out. That's sometimes good, sometimes noise that we say we want one pair, but sometimes we get two pairs. Okay, this, you have to balance your situation. But this is the setup, no? Down conversion, three photons go in here. It's the cartoon image of our unitary. But it did not mention there's an entire business around it. It has to be a very, very random unitary. There's this harm measure, you should not know anything about the unitary. If it's identity, it's trivial, of course, no? So there's some kind of assumptions to make it really like a hard post-sampling experiment, which is not mentioned here right now. So if you're asking why it's interesting, that's the answer. And I like to show this slide with basically all the talks that give post-sampling. Does somebody know this car? What's this car about? Come on, Brazilians must love cars. Yes, supersonic. SSC, supersonic car. Was the first car that broke the sound barrier on ground. Okay? It couldn't do anything. It's basically a rocket with wheels. Okay? It couldn't do anything. Just go straight. Not left, not right, not even brakes. No rooftop, nothing. But it has one mission. Be faster than the sound on ground. The same is true for boson sampling. It cannot do anything useful in my eyes, at least now, okay? But it's fast. Fast in the sense you don't only 20 photons, 400 modes. One of the simplest approaches you can imagine to build a computer, because you can design the unitary. But it's fast. It means you can break, hopefully, the barrier. You can say, look, this result by no means can be calculated by classical ones, okay? From the complexity class argument. Not talking about Bell inequalities and so, really like computation arguments. So you can really prove, hopefully, there is no fundamental limit that things are faster than classical computers. And there's still debates if there's a threshold, if there's a limit, because nowadays with just a few qubits, people argue there might be complexity class arguments, artifacts showing up that really will never surpass a situation that we can have a controlled quantum computation going beyond a classical machine. For me, boson sampling is a hot candidate to be like supersonic cars, fast, okay? Of course, it's still a long way, but it's not crazy. If you compare the numbers here to Shor's algorithm, it's not millions of qubits and millions of gate. It's more or less something which is not so crazy, and I hope we will see results of these numbers before I retire, okay? I hope I don't retire at 120 years old, but in the next reasonable 20, 30 years, it can be done with such a machinery. Okay, the other thing we are now looking at, since boson sampling might have more to offer, is basically to study, can we tune something? So what can you tune? Basically, photons do not overlap properly, and basically you have different interference effects. It can be seen as noise handling or as tuning parameter. So we've done basically our interesting features. We'd like to change the distinguishability of photons by putting some temporal delay. So if nature knows, yes, you guys come a little bit earlier than the other one, of course you move towards a classical situation. That's basically shown here that we have a little delay between photons. You can use anything to make it distinguishable, different frequencies, whatever, different spatial modes. We choose time delays. What you're going to see is then when you change basically the degree of how indistinguishable they are, of course the interference is not as good. So the Hong-Mantel effect that we've seen will of course not be that deep as before. And what you do in mathematics is visibility goes down, and it's described by these terms. So when you do the mathematics, you see these terms that give you the coincidence related to permanence, shown before, but also determinants. In the perfect case, determinant here, determinant there disappears, just this kind of permanence survive. And the parameter that basically tunes is the overlap integral, in other words, how distinguishable these guys are. And you see this visibility can be linked to this kind of term there as a tuning parameter, what's happening in interference. We just changed it by delaying, then you also get this tuning here. The nice thing that we observed is that in our description, independent of what kind of beam splitter you choose, 50-50s, 19-10, whatever you have in mind is unitary, if photons are perfectly indistinguishable, it's always the permanent that kicks into 100%, okay? So even though you have beam splitters with 19-10, which give you visibilities of the green, for example, not perfect 50-50. You know, when we sometimes build gates out of that, different transmission, different reflection. Even though it might not be 50-50, you still have perfect permanent contributions there, which allows a mathematical framework to nicely decouple the structure from what kind of interference is happening there. That was actually a nice situation. So we can really decouple the circuits from the interference behavior in terms of mathematical descriptions using permanence determinants. Good, that's the experiment. We delayed the photons, looked at the outputs there, and then we got some kind of landscapes as shown here. Landscapes means you get huge terms. Immediately you see like 60 terms just for three photons describing determinant, permanent, and immanent. Immanent basically is the general class of, okay, hand wavy. Permanent, only pluses. Determinant, plus and minus. Everything in between is immanent. Huge class. Nobody knows about if they're really as complex as the permanents. But you see this kind of bunches of terms there which are interesting on its own and allow you to characterize what's happening in your interferometer. So what we have done is we have basically three input photons coming from here. Looked how they come out, for example, at these three modes. Then when they change the delays, you get different spots. So here, when the photons are perfectly indistinguishable, permanent contribution. If they're here, all are different. Then you have basically a lot of determinants in there. And then you have points in between, which allow you to characterize the machinery. Why do we do it? To understand noise, because photons are never perfectly distinguishable. And even to get tuning parameters to see if we can perform computations that changing slightly how distinguishable they are, because the mathematics of this immanence and so on could be as interesting, as hard as the permanent argument for the computation. Good. We have done a few different configurations, just to show how the event lists work. What you see is you can always map it to permanent immanent contribution. And you see basically the more you move away from the perfect spot, here P1 is the perfect, you have mostly permanence. It's never purely permanent in real life because you have noise, photons are always slightly distinguishable. Should be everything red here, but it's not. There's still some sneaking of immanence for some cases. But what you see for sure is when you go to this spot, P6, far away from both, all three photons are different, then you see permanent contributions are basically disappearing. And you see mostly this orange and determinant, so orange is immanent and blue is determinant. You see basically these terms kick in, basically showing yes, you have a classical situation more or less happening there, and gives us a nice insight into such a boson sampling device. Good, something I could not resist to show a little teaser, but just a few slides because we will talk next week, plenty of them, but just came out today, so just something that we, in terms of simulating and using the flexibility of photons, it's nice to think of superposition of gates. I promise just 2-3 slides will not take a show. Because next week I think there will be 2 talks, theory and experimental talks about that. But in principle, the idea is, okay, wait, one step back, computation. What you learn, where computational speedups come from, is the superposition of the input states. You can have zeros and ones at the same time, okay? And then you have your Hadamards, you superpose them, you have your gates, you have the phases and so on. The thing that turned out for computer scientists is that you can also basically have superpositions for the heart, for the computational gates itself, okay? Instead of having them fixed one after the other, you can also superimpose those operations, which are interesting because they allow you, or give you a speed up. So in a quick cartoon, you can have one or this, first this operation, or the other operation, and you have U1, then U2, or first U2, U1. Quantum mechanics allows you to superimpose them. There's nice theory work from Mateusz, we'll talk next week, that you can rephrase this as a circuit structure. There's a photon coming here, and you see basically depending on the polarization state, each photon goes up here, goes this path, and at this situation, at this and that. If it's vertically polarized, goes the other way first, is reflected, and then goes this one. So you can see by choosing a superposition of both H and V, you can superimpose first U1, U2, or first U2 or U1. If you phrase it mathematically, you can build a switch out of that. So what's the point? The point is, the superimposing gates, you have a speed up compared to quantum computers, okay? So you see, you can really have some quadratic speed up, but this linear advantage to other algorithms by superimposing the gate orders. What we have done to the simple experiment, we could ask basically more efficiently the computator relation. For me, more interesting from the fundamental point of view is to have superposition of causal structures where you say A affects B, or when B affects something else, A is really superimposed, this kind of configuration, which I think are interesting from fundamental questions. Okay, I will jump forward, we'll not mention that because there will be talks next week. Something I would like to mention, because these guys probably would not, sometimes you make failures, and these are fun to see, okay? So, failure was, I have to show a little bit, we had in mind to do an experiment that we have superposition of gate AB and the order AB. So you see, polarization defines the order. If you superimpose the polarization, you superimpose AB and BA. And the nice thing you can test, for example, do the commute or not commute and give you a phase. So you said, okay, let's do it. Let's build an experiment. And the first idea was, let's do it like here. The polarization defines which path is taken, and then you make your gate. And we built such a device as here, where polarization comes. If it's H polarized, it's a polarized beam splitter, you go this path first, down. First unitary, then we go here. Second unitary, we go home. Or if you're vertically polarized, you go other direction. First unitary, down, 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 then we go home, okay? However, even though the idea was great, and that's honestly nice to say, we learned it's very hard to implement, because here you implement a phase operation as degree of freedom. It was so hard that the fluctuation, even on a small scale here, basically gave so much errors, such high error rates, that we were not confident about the results. Of course, if you would have integrated circuits available, then you could do it. But as I mentioned, the problem is handling polarization degrees of freedom is still a pain. So it was at that time not possible to have a circuit in integrated structures that could fulfill the requirements as shown by such a device. Smart students said, okay, let's change the game. And smart students said, well, let me use something that's not so phase sensitive, because phase sensitive means the phase here must be super precise. Every wind, every touch would give a phase shift, which actually was the control parameter. So my student said, no, then let's actually use polarization as the unitaries 1 and 2, and path as the other degree of freedom. And that's what happened then at the final stage, that you have a photon coming, and the 50-50 beam splitter, not polarizing beam splitter, says, go straight or be reflected. If you go straight, you have one order, you reflect the other order, and so on. And, but again, it's basically with one-shot superposition of the unitaries, allowing it to extract interesting stuff. We'll not mention that, these are the results, many things were done, but at the end it came out today, which is the nice feature about that. Good, the thing I have 10 minutes left, I would like to jump, because it's it might be touching some of quantum computation per se, I'm not sure about that yet, but it uses the similar configuration as for this causal order experiment, that we are going to hear the real story next week, is to use photonic systems and similar constructions to obtain insights into the mathematics or of quantum physics. As you might remember from the basic courses, you can choose your favorite mathematical description. You can use real numbers as well to explain the entire quantum physics, but the pain is you have to use systematics or other extra degrees of real numbers and freedom to characterize everything. Complex numbers, what we learned from high school, are the natural choice and very handy because you have all those things together. But there's still higher orders, and they go back to Hamilton, basically of development in mathematics, where you have basically four elements or even eight elements, quaternions, four, or octonions, eight elements. So a quaternic, so why do you say this? Because in principle you can build the full framework of quantum physics also from these quaternions, where you have description is here, you have a real number, and then you have three imaginaries. If there would be only one, it's a complex number, but you have the three imaginaries. It's totally fine, it's a full honest mathematical framework. And in fact, particle physicists and so on tend to use those kind of descriptions, or when you have many work with these tensors of the fourth level, like the general relativity, because they're very handy, okay? However, there is a slightly different, or important difference actually to complex numbers, because those A, J, K, those three imaginary numbers, as shown here, okay, have to obey these kind of rules. But the point is, they do not commute. So quaternions do not commute in contrast to complex numbers. Okay? So the idea of using higher order systems, higher complex numbers for theory descriptions, goes back to at least von Neumann. Maybe previous people have talked about that. It was Escher-Perez who suggested, well, we can do an experiment to point out there might be, if you can observe this kind of feature. So what I'm trying to say is, if you choose another mathematical framework, you might see strange behaviors by using this mathematical framework, even though it's totally correct. Okay. Good. So what does it mean? It means that when you build an interferometer like here, okay, and you can imagine that if you put now two phase shifters, phase shift A and phase shift B, it doesn't matter if you have complex numbers, it first comes A and then B all the way around, if it's here. You just collect the phase in total. That's not true for that's only true for complex numbers, but not true for quaternions, because here that we show this kind of non-commuting behavior. What's the point here? That's not something nobody knows. The phase that's described or that shows up from the system here must be different in the sense of the underlying nature of the phase shift here. Should be different between those two. If two times you use two times glass, it's the same quaternion number. If you use two times something else, glass, and a very different physical mechanism, then you expect you should see some kind of interference or the non-commutivity showing up. Okay, last 5 minutes, I promise. So as usual, the first experiments are done by neutron guys, because back in the days there was the only system more or less available. And they said, yes, let's make a test. So let's make a test if precisely they measure only phase shift A, only phase shift B, and they measure AB or BA. To be sure that there are different physical mechanisms to have chosen different things in neutral interferometer. What's different thing? Different thing is different cross-section, positive or negative scattering length. Basically, that's basically how the material talks to neutrons. And that's basically what's done here. You have an interferometer, neutron comes, goes one path for the other, there's a mirror, basically, for this neutron situation, that comes out. And as you remember, if everything works nicely, all the neutrons go out at one output port, for example, there. And you put in titanium or aluminum. That's phase shift A, phase shift B, and then you change to different configuration. You see what happened? Interference was tuned with nothing in there, just element A, just element B, AB and BA. And basically, when they compared the different fringes, they could say, well, with precision up to 0.3% or degree, and there was nothing to observe. And that was basically done many years ago. So with in mind, can we go beyond that? Can we A, improve the resolution? Can we put a better boundary condition on quaternions might not be the way to choose for quantum physics? Or can we basically also talk about different situations, because photons are massless particles and they have relativistic effects? You have to test, you don't know the answer. We have to make a test to be convinced that this is the case. So what we have done basically, what in mind is to do the same stuff by being now even. And use the advantages of photons to fold the interferometer to be even more stable by having a Sagnac arrangement where light comes in, goes either this path and goes out, or light comes in, it's reflected, goes that path. You see, if you put AB, you immediately have first BA or first AB superposition. Very nice. Then light goes out. If there's no difference in AB or BA, all light would go out back to here. If there's a phase shift showing up, you would expect that this dark port has some kind of leakage in there. So what's the problem? The problem is to find very different physical mechanisms. So one thing to bear in mind then is basically use a piece of glass, some birefringent material, it was like a liquid crystal as shown there. And you see basically when you can apply voltage, you can really change how much is birefringent and so on. But on the other side of the technology spectrum, what's very different to that is use a metal material which couldn't be any more different effect to light by using such a device which we got for the other element. So A is metal material, B is the liquid crystal. By arranging them you could really say, well, yeah, if there's something happening, you might have good a starting point to see if some phase shifts come from this non-commutivity of quaternions. To read out the phase shift, you have to add actually another interferometer here, which allows to tune a phase, and therefore you get higher sensibility or better readout features for if something comes out there, because you can tune basically degree of freedom. Just details at this point, not worth to mention how it goes, but in principle you need this one as readout device to be basically also magnitude more convinced that you know what's happening there. Okay, that's the real picture again, looks similar to the Kostler order structure. laser comes, the laser source sends the photon, and then basically comes here the Sagnac configuration. You go first here, sorry, this one is the part, you go this beam splitter, this way, or that way. Then if the light comes out, it has to be like going this path, or if some leakage comes, also that path, and then you can really get the clicks here as a characterization of the amount of phase. What you expect to see is, if complex numbers are there, you expect no phase showing up at all, so you will see always a flat line of the counts, no matter how you tune the measurement knob to read out, you would expect to see some kind of phases showing up if there's some anti-commutator relation. The mathematics is basically rephrased by the commutator and anti-commutator situation of the elements. Here's the probability to see the phase, just details, but not so much. But the key message is, at the end of the day, no machinery is perfect, okay? So you always have little mismatches, little imperfections, which gives you always some kind of leakage, some kind of wrong signal out there, because that's basically real life conditions. So if there's nothing in there, expect interferometer work perfectly, all the light to one output port, you still see some kind of leakage. And that's shown here. So what we have done, the measurement apparatus was tuned to be perfectly now 50-50 outcome. And if you change the phase, you see it bounces slightly back and forth between those two detectors at the end. The same somehow noise can be seen if you have one element in, the same noise can be seen for the other element, and if you have both, we measure simultaneously the commutator relations, we have more or less the same visibility here. So after getting many data, and really was a high precision measurements for our standards, we could really put down the visibility fluctuations to those 0.038 numbers we see very small, which at the end of the day gives us a very good confidence, including all the noises we understand, to at least 10 to minus 3 as the lowest boundary condition of if there's a commutator, if there's some kind of commutating relation showing up. In other words, we don't see this quaternic behavior up to this kind of 10 to minus 3 level here in terms of visibility showing up. Actually, we see 10 to minus 4, but keeping the noise in the behavior of machinery, we are convinced only up to 10 to minus 3 currently of our experiment, which is a nice experiment, at least putting some boundary in what we think is currently the threshold for, yes, complex numbers are the way to system works, basically. Good, that's the last slide. I just mentioned a few things about computation simulation. The thing we'd like to give is take-home message. No matter what you like to do as a specialist, it's always fun, okay? So that's what we have done. Many groups do beautiful other stuff. And if you have one quantum optic system in your hand, you can choose basically what you like to do. So very often it's just tiny changes in parameters. You go from a simulator to a communicator to a metrology device to computation. In the end, it's fun, okay? So it's nice to see an experiment that I'm really convinced. It's really fun to see an experiment. The results, the quantum mechanical features showing there's a click on the screen and say, yes, we see this kind of gate happening. And I encourage you guys, to those of you who would like to do experiments, doesn't matter what kind of group you choose, what kind of stuff, but sometimes it's fun to work with it, and then by yourself you find the right knobs to go to the right experimental challenges. And you see the photons, you can really address many different things. Good, with that I want to say thank you very much for staying with me for the three lectures. I want to say thank you to all the organizers for inviting me. It was a pleasure. From the particular boat ride yesterday, was really awesome. Still got a little headache, I don't know where from. But it was time. I have to leave today, so I must apologize. If there are questions, then please catch me now. In roughly half an hour, I have to run way towards back to Rio. But it was my pleasure. You're a great audience, and I hope you enjoy the last days in Paraguay as much as I did the previous days. Okay. Thanks, bye.
Alright guys, let's open for some questions.
It was the easiest to choose this particular one, but you can also take others from the side. You can rewrite this from Newtonian. So we've taken this one because it was the easiest candidate to mimic the gate operations for that, but you could also. So, So we'll stand together with Frank Estrade, a theoretician in Vienna, where we add our expertise to how we can find the simplest experimental conditions to get still interesting simulations out of them.
More questions? I have one about boson sampling.
Yes.
Do you know if there is any practical computing problem that could be solvable by the outputs of the boson sample?
No, but people work on that. So the idea is to mimic some of the questions from fermionic problems actually to this boson sampling behavior. So this idea to make this is an onion, that some part of the onion is done by boson sampling, and then you map those kind of stuff to other questions that are related to fermions, for example. But of course, many theory groups try to basically figure out if there's something related to that. But ask theoreticians, please, they know better than I do.
Any further questions?
So, concerning these superconducting detectors that you have, so can you resolve like one photon, two photons? How do
it depends,
work?
Yes, it depends, but which is the two technologies out there. One is like the transition edge detectors, which are the thing of not shown. They need to be in colder temperatures, they're like poliometers. They can resolve basically up to 10 photons that come. They give you a signal depending on the strength of the number of photons. The problem with them is they're slow. So the reader is hard, and the way how they work is like really from milli microsecond up to 100 milliseconds, they're blind, okay? Which is a problem in terms of our business. We have past systems, we always send photons all the time. You might see it, quite get lucky with one time, but then we're so long blind that at the end you don't see anything. So the system we chose is the nanowires, which are super fast, almost have the same efficiency, so the transition edge at 99, we are 93%. What we do is to make pseudo number resolve, which means basically cascading of beam splitters. When you have one mode and you have many beam splitters, there's a chance that photons go to different modes. You can do it with technology in the sense that you have a spot where the photon comes and you put three or four nanowires next to each other. Then when two photons come, you have a 75% chance to be split up. It gets better asymptotically with more detectors there, but that's the way we have chosen to work with because we are so fast that we can really have extremely high generation rates for our multi-photon business.
Any more? Well, if there is no question, let's thank Philip again for the nice lecture.